I want to thank all of you for coming out today. This is the smallest audience we've ever had. And I'm going to introduce Mr. Stuckey, Charles Stuckey, who wrote a marvelous little something about in our brochure and this book for the Museum of Modern Art. What was the series called?
One on One.
And I believe you can purchase it at the Museum of Modern Art. Charlie has a long career. He was curator at the National Gallery, the Art Institute of Chicago, the Kimball Art Museum in Minneapolis, which was his training for the day, the winter in Minneapolis, and Sam was right.
And he made it a lot longer than I did.
And he's written many books and articles over the years. But what really impressed me is that in 1997, he was made Chevalier of the Légion d'Honneur. And he's our first conversationalist for that
distinction.
So, Brian, you want to introduce
yourself? Yes, I'm Brian Washburn from the Washburn Gallery. I'd like to happy to introduce Judith Goldman. She is an independent writer and curator. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm wrong. Founding editor of the Print Collector Newsletter from 1969 to 1972. Curator of prints at the Whitney Museum of American Art from 1977 to 1991. And she was a curator of the Skull Collection exhibition, the Portrait of a Collection at the Apple Gallery. Did I do okay?
That's Rosie.
And currently Rosie.
And I forgot to mention that currently Charlie is working on the catalog resume Yves Tanguy.
Oh, okay.
For the Pierre Matisse.
That's right. But just paintings
just
and washes.
Paint. That's
Yves Tanguy also made friends with Hayter.
Oh, did he?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, he did.
Sure.
I mean, we have lots to learn.
So, how should we start? You're the one who knows about the history of prints.
Well, I know a little bit. Yeah. Shall I start about a bit about Hayter, and then we'll put Pollock into the equation?
Sure.
Is that the way?
Sure.
Since these were made, all the engravings were made at Hayter's workshop in 1944 and 45, not these particular ones, but the original plates. Hayter came to America in 1940 to escape France and the war, and opened a workshop called Atelier 17 as part of the New School for Social Research. He was passionate about coppice plate engraving. He was passionate about intaglio. He could, the dry point was okay, etching was okay, but it was the copper plate that got him, it was engraving that got him, and he disdained other graphic media. He called people who made woodcuts, he called woodpeckers. he was a artist first and a teacher, but as a teacher he was a zealot. He was a charismatic and a proselytizer about what you could get out of the copper plate, what the burn could do, and what all the loops, the loopingness you could get with a burin as opposed to a knife or working on a stone. And I thought it would be a good idea to read three descriptions of other people of Hayter's workshop. And the first one is Jacob Kanan, painter and printmaker who worked at Atelier 17. Everyone at the studio was on their own. Hayter would tell them to ruin the plate. He urged them to start without sketches, take proofs, re-etch, add dry point, do everything. The idea was to make the artist lose his fear of the plate and also to make it an intuitive process. He had a lot to do with the development of the automatic point of view. Now here's a more fulsome description by Anais Nin from her diary, which is, I think, think we printed them, you're for sure. The place was enticing to me with piles of paper, inks, the presses, the vats with acid, the copper being worked upon, the miraculous lines appearing from the presses, the colored inks, the sharpened burns, the group working with him absorbed, intent, bent over under strong naked bulbs. He always moved about between the students, cyclonic, making Joycean puns, a character, a joke. He was always in motion. His lines were like projectiles thrown in space, sometimes tangled with like antennae caught in a windstorm. To me, he was a wire sculpture, a man of nerves. And finally, here's Peter's description of his New York workshop, and it carries a really intriguing suggestion of something that might have influenced Pollock. We had an experimental approach and created an environment where things could happen. We were not teaching people to carry out the operations of printmaking. Here's an example of what we did. It's really interesting. A drip can hung on a compound pendulum. It was an ordinary can with the top and bottom cut out, and a cone inserted that was filled with buck, a kind of bitumen. Bitumen is an asphalt used as a ground or a spot-out varnish in printmaking. And it swung in a discontinuous cyclical motion, and the stuff dripped in some very odd patterns. It was a toy to play with, used and seen by many. I find that quite fascinating.
And he himself is remembering that.
Hader is remembering that, and Hader is describing it in a conversation in a book about surrealism in itself.
Yeah, I mean, it's always difficult to know just, I mean, how important he was. I mean, Hader evidently remembered late in life that he had had an enormous impact on Pollock, taught Pollock everything he knows, sort of. I mean, but just in a one-shot comment. And so, I wonder whether he even overdoing it. I think that Pollock didn't want to go to Hader's because there were too many people there. And whether he was agoraphobic or whether he was secretive or for whatever reason, I had the impression that the advantage that he was able to take of the situation, at least from his side of the story, or Ruby Hader's side of the story, was that they sort of stayed away, except in the evening or on weekends when nobody else was there, so that they wouldn't have to go through the group exercise and the student-teacher relationship. But I think he felt before he wanted to get into it, he wanted to see a little bit on his own what was going on. Yeah.
I would agree with that. I think
it sounds a little bit more believable, but you know how history is. I mean, there are all different sides to the story.
Right, and you know, and Atelier 17 made its own story, and Hader made his own story,
sure,
and all the artists that worked there, the most esteemed was probably Pollock, who worked there very briefly. I mean, not most of seen in the world sense, not in the printmaking.
Right. I mean, in the sense of, I'm asking you as the old print curator, but I mean, if you're in during World War II, I mean, are there, what's the status of contemporary printmaking worldwide? I mean, obviously Picasso has devoted himself to printmaking in a way that really was a little unimaginable to think that it would become such a huge part of his practice. And Matisse, but was that something that New York artists were aware of? Was how to be a really important artist, you would have to address the history of prints and the world of printmaking. I just don't know the answer.
I think the answer is probably no. Printmaking in Europe was not separate from making paintings or making sculpture. There wasn't a print world that was separate from Picasso made prints, Matisse made prints, Chagall made prints. There were places to make the work in Paris. Hayter comes from England. He's a transplant to France. In America at that time, it's a considered a craft more than it's considered a fine art. It's very separated. The artists, like New York artists, so like Isabel Bishop and Reginald Marsh, are making prints. But artists that knew how to make prints, those artists, interestingly, from what I've read, they didn't take to haters. They already knew what they wanted to do, and they were making sketches of the city. American printmaking doesn't really, there were the regionalists before that who made socially significant prints, but it's really not until the 1960s with the growth of printmaking workshops and the establishment of Cameron that the American painter incorporates printmaking.
Right.
There.
Because Pollock had made WPA type prints.
He made the one,
there are a number of lithographs and things that he did in the 30s. Very sort of, I mean, he didn't come to, let's supposing that he went to Hayter's studio on a weekend evening with his friend Louis Gators. I mean, he didn't go as a complete innocent to printmaking.
Well,
he had tried his hand at it before, maybe not actually.
He did a series of lithographs, right?
Right.
And then he did the etchings, and then he did the screen prints. And there are these three singular points that he works in printmaking, and there's no continuation from one to the other.
Right.
But how influential do you think his time at Hayter's would have been to his, better word, mature painting style? Did it have an influence?
I think you could argue that it may have. In terms of the scale of these are supposed to date from
44, 45,
I think is what people. Is what people say. So I mean, they're I suppose they're most comparable in a catalog raisonne way to his drawings from that period, and there aren't very many drawings from the period that are this size. There's just a couple. I mean, there's a certain level of ambition, I think, that is sort of implied in these. That would be fulfilled as a graphic artist in the years ahead, as he had clients for them, as people would like, wanted to buy a drawing instead of just having them be notes and doodles and something that you give to your psychiatrist every now and then. As a gift, or I guess maybe paid it for services, I'm not sure, but
or to show what you're thinking about.
Yeah, I mean, trying to, these are always so marginal to the Jackson Pollock story because he's kind of in and out of it, and it's easy enough to sort of ignore the prints and say, well, he obviously had at most a half-hearted interest in it. On the other hand, the graphic energy in these images is certainly at least on a par with, if not in advance of, the graphic energy in his contemporary paintings and drawings. And I think if he had moved out to the Hamptons, he may have, this may have got his teeth into him more. But situationally, because he was having so many problems, I mean, it's hard to imagine somebody with so many personal problems all at once, as Pollock was having at the time that this opportunity was presented to him. And so he obviously he needed to escape from his environment and go someplace else, and I took him away from the prints. I've often wondered, maybe you would, since I've never picked up a burn in my life or put a piece of, you know, copper into acid bath or anything of the sort, it's the speed of the lines in these that I find so striking. I mean, to me, looking at them and letting my eyes sort of, you know, wander and wonder and, you know, like, where is something starting and stopping? It's as if he graphically he's kind of able to isolate, and yet I feel there's got to be sort of more resistance from the metal to the burin than there would be to a pencil on a piece of paper. And yet I don't really have that impression.
You don't? No, you're right. Yeah. It looks absolutely immediate, like he's a great figure skater, and it's really quite. They're engravings. They're not etchings. And if there were etchings, it would make, you could just draw like this or paint like this with a brush. But he's using a burin, which is a triangular diamond-shaped tool that he's holding in this hand. And the copper plate is here. And the copper plate usually does underneath it a piece of soft, copper-thick, I forget what's in it, but there's a cushion underneath it. So he's literally turning the plate with this hand as the burn is moving. It's very hard to do, and it was, of course, to get that immediacy that doesn't look at all worked over, particularly in this one,
sure,
is quite extraordinary. And he's working on the copper. There's no ground on it. He's working on the polished copper. So he had a gift for it. There's no doubt about that. That seems clear.
So just stylistically, there's a level of strength that's involved, is what I hear you say.
There's a level of control, of control to get the look of
But then it's often said what's so imminent in the printmaking idea for Pollock then as a superhero artist is the idea that he's working on something on a tabletop. He's on top of it the way he would later be on top of a canvas if you put it on the floor to paint on. And it illustrates his room.
It frees it from the easel.
I think he's often quoted as saying, I like to work on a hard surface. I need some resistance. You know, that's why I put things against the wall or I put them on the floor, but I want something that's, you know, I want sort of a struggle between me and the surface.
Yeah. And also his ability, the fact that he's moving around to make it, he's moving around on all sides of the plate. The plate is moving around, so he could be working on the plate upside down.
Well, when I look at these, I often think that, I'm seeing images that are this way and that way. There's evidence of sort of images and representation everywhere, but it's completely incoherent. I mean, the things that start. You lose your way before you can finally stop it. Yeah, and then something else seems to start and go off on its own tangent and so on. So graphically, everything is.
There's no evolution, and there's no evolution from one print to the other. But what there is probably a great involvement in the process. That's something you might have gotten from Hayter, because what Hayter, not that he even necessarily talked to Hayter there, but that was the emphasis. The emphasis was on being completely subsumed by the process, by moving through it. But the irony in that was that it required technique.
What about time? I mean, if we're talking about someone who's just speaking in on the weekend, but what would you say from your print background? How many hours was he at Haber's, just judging from the prints that were given? Were there 11 plates that
there
were
11,
found
there? Okay, so let's picture this. It's 8th Street, it's dark at night. He's with his friend Ruben. Ruben's got the keys. It's an empty studio. Maybe there are a couple of other people working around. It smells of asphaltium. It's dimly lit. It's over a fair period of time. He could make that in a night easily, just drawing, if he's there for 3 or 4 hours.
Uh-huh. Would you give a night a piece?
This one there, in the middle of that wall.
Oh, that's beautiful.
It's a beautiful one, but that one looks like he went back over it a number of times. That one looks like he was really more involved in it over and over again.
And there are different states for some of these.
Yes,
there, I mean,
the Museum of Modern Art Academy has trial proofs of it. I think what's good to remember, though, that they came, we didn't see, he makes them, and nobody sees them until, correct me if I'm wrong or right about this, until 1967 when they're printed posthumously.
I think in the catalog recently, they do have a couple of examples where he gave a proof to Rosenberg, or he colored over a proof and developed a work on paper from it that was probably acquired as a unique work rather than as ever from a print edition. But they didn't just go into it completely into it.
The Modern has trial proofs.
The Modern has trial proofs.
With the plates.
Yeah, right.
But they're not editioned until 1967.
That's right.
Right.
And then the plates are found, as supposedly, by Krasner, and then they're cleaned by Gabor Pettity, who worked at the workshop, and they're... But it's done, as I understand it, under the auspices of Lieberman, William Lieberman, who was at the Modern at the time. So, and yet, at that time, you asked about the print world. The print world was very, very parochial and said, unless it was signed and numbered by the artists, they weren't interested in it. There was an American Society of Graphic Artists, and they were scorned. They forgot that Dürer didn't make his plates, and they forgot that Rembrandt used a plate until it wore out. And they said, it was always under a certain kind of cloud as far as the print world went. So they weren't seen as much. They weren't seen as much as one would have thought they should have been.
Right.
That's all.
Right. But they did appear almost simultaneously with the psychoanalytic drawing.
Yeah, that's interesting.
And they got so much attention. And was it the Whitney that did the show at the time, I think? I mean, that had,
right.
It seems to me that had so much attention. And these would have been, the perfect supplement to that.
And he's making them right afterward. I mean, the Jungian drawings, he's taking some of those to his analyst as well?
Yeah, we're changing analysts along the way.
Right.
forget all the different names. But I think, at this point, I think there's a Henderson involved.
There's a Henderson.
And the ones that were, I thought, were from Eliza.
Uh-huh.
But they in that sense, there is an element to these as well as everything else that there's some exploration somehow or other. these go back to the surrealist theory of self-exploration through automatism. In fact, that would be perfectly situated in the exhibition I've always wondered why never happened, which is automatism. I've always thought that, that besides collage, probably it was the most influential idea in the 20th century, pictorially speaking, and yet I've never really seen it looked at as an international interest, a sort of an underlying principle of investigation, that somehow if you could only let yourself go, you were on the threshold of not only self-revelations, but self-revelations that could be communicated
to
your audience.
Who would you include in an exhibition like that?
Who would I include in an exhibition like that?
Automatism.
Well, I think we go from Andre Masson, I suppose, is everybody's poster child for the first of the gap. But I mean, it would continue up through Twombly and, you know, and beyond. It's been a steady beat, it seems to me, in international art since the 20s. And even though there's been relatively little interest in this country in surrealism, per se, I mean, it's the kind of thing that
that's changed.
You want to come out and say, I'm not a surrealist the way I'm not a Republican, but but automatism as a working principle of the Church of Surrealism, that's all right. I mean, nobody ever complained about automatism.
Hmm. Interesting.
Yeah, and it's just that I would think that, you know, making engravings on copper would be a fairly difficult.
It is, but one of the things he would have seen in this dark studio at night would have been a print by Masson that was hanging there.
Mm-hmm.
That would have probably, and I did, I thought it would be interesting for everyone to see this.
Gorgeous.
Yeah. But it would have been there, supposedly.
And so would he.
Yes, but not at night.
Not at night.
No, I agree with you. I think that the emphasis that's been placed on Hayter's influence or the influence of the crowd around there is completely blown up and not necessarily right.
It's interesting to me too, thinking ahead in terms of scale, because I think with the name of film, there has been a sort of an unavoidable idea that you don't really get the full Pollock unless the entire body is into it as a dance. And yet these are such manual, these are such a matter of fingers and wrists, and yet it's the same thing. The body dance comes somehow after this. And it's always sort of astonishing to think that it would have begun as a more miniature art form that then, you know, the change from one to the other. Because I think that many people, you know, looking at these will sort of think of them as marginalia to the large works. But they're really more a prolegomena than a marginalia.
Well, he's working around them too. He's circulating, he's not staying. He's not working in one place. He's not looking at it one way. Except this one, maybe. But most of the others, they're moving.
Circular.
And it's not clear that you can't, as you said before, you can't look at it and say, oh, he was working from this angle. Well, he could have been working from the left, the right, or from up above. But
that very early painting in the back room has some of this. You know, little tiny. Ryan, maybe you could get that, just bring it out.
And the other thing that's interesting is one of the things a burin can do is it can make extraordinarily loops in the way you can push it and make a curved, looping shape.
No, I'm talking about the painting brush.
That is not, you can't do with any other.
Which was done in the early 30s.
Seemingly.
34, 38. Uh-huh. Four panels.
Right.
But And then even there, there's a certain sense of motion that...
Absolutely. Energy made visible.
Yes.
Uh-huh. The hollow and the bump. It's all, it's bare, it's, yeah. More 38 than 34, maybe.
Yeah.
But,
anyway.
Yeah. I mean, I think that kind of energy is...
that's what it's drinking.
Is a conflict. But it becomes more linear. You know? I think
that's the line
that's,
is what,
that,
so
yeah.
that's what the line,
yeah,
if
right.
you had to
yeah.
take
that's
one thing out
that.
Of these and say, what was it, it might be the emphasis on the line that influenced him.
Yeah.
His later work.
Right, because, exactly, the later work, for a while at least, gets more and more linear, I guess, until around 1950. Just the staggered people's lives. And and so I suppose that whatever flirtation he's making with a, you know, with a medium that would be so preponderantly linear and in terms of layers, starting and stopping and, you know, looking and then going back and putting on another layer and so on and so forth. That those would all be parallels to the eventual large scale style.
And he has no choice because the tool only makes lines. I mean, he can't be doing something else with it.
Right.
It's not.
Do you think these have anything to do with the idea for putting out a portfolio in 1950?
No.
No.
I think they're very different. I mean, they're very different. They're different mediums and they're different.
Yeah, but just sort of the fulfillment of you know, having of expressing yourself.
Well, these are photographic screen prints.
Right.
And so these are he's.
These are of paintings.
Right.
They're of paintings. They're of something that reads.
Right. But they're of black and white paintings.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, which
that's interesting.
Are reduced.
He doesn't ever make
to ink.
He only makes black and white prints. His early lithographs are all black and white.
Right.
And that's sort of ironic because Hayter became famous for his color theories after a while.
Uh-huh.
So that would speak to your point that Hayter wasn't necessarily as great an influence,
right,
as people think.
And the show in 1951 caused a pure uproar on 57th Street because the figure was emerging again.
It was okay for de Kooning, but not for Pollock.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
they didn't think that they would sell any of the paintings. So they got the idea of doing a portfolio of screen prints, and they didn't sell either. Nothing sold at that point.
At that point.
Yeah.
Do you think they
would relate? Do I think they were? Well, only in the black and white way. You know, I find that, you know, that whole block. They did a show of all the black and white work. Two or three years ago now, and it was curious that the prints per se weren't addressing it. I mean, they took it in different directions, but not to the prints. And because the, you know, the paintings in the show are essentially gigantic. Exercises in a process that's much closer to printmaking than his previous work. You know, I suppose he's responded to Franz Klein and Kooning and all the other painting black and white works at the moment. But it's also a response to the limitations of printmaking.
Any questions?
What do you think? Exactly. The audience is full of people who know more about than we do.
Any questions?
Or comments?
Or comments?
Can you just go over, maybe you did it at the beginning, can you just go over the dates, of, like the chronology of the printmaking versus the printing of the works?
He makes the plates for the engravings in the winter, I think, of 44 and 45. Mm-hmm. He makes approximately 11 plates. He makes proofs of these plates and trial proofs, some of which he colors over and gives to people. Some of them are, those proofs are in the collection of the Museum of Modern Art. Then in 1967, the painter's widow, Lee Krasner, finds them and has them additioned under the supervision of Bill Lieberman, who was then the curator of prints at the Museum of Modern Art. Those plates are cleaned by Pederty, but I think there are only 7 editions made of the 11, and printed by a man named Emilio Cerini. And that's it.
These go to 47. From 44 to 47.
Oh, they go to 47. I didn't know that.
And one of them signed in the plate, right? At least one of them.
That I don't know.
I think so.
So if they go to 47, he's
that's
working there later than 44 and 45.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
If the dating is correct. You know.
Right. I mean, I think it's, we're going to just be in a perpetual guessing game about the dating. I don't think it's very.
When did he move? I should know this. When did he move to Springs?
45, right?
I don't know.
Yeah.
In 45. Well, then maybe this dating is incorrect.
Well, that would be a big leap because every 44, 45. Maybe one is dated 47.
We go by the catalog raising one.
Yeah, I mean, that is
the
right.
And when that was done, certainly prints were not.
And their engravings were
important compared to the paintings.
Well, absolutely.
Yeah.
And I they just, you didn't know where to put them in the story. I mean, the story of the paintings is a story of exhibitions. I mean, unlike a lot of artistic biographies, in the case of Jackson Pollock, I mean, from the time he's with Art of the Century, he's constantly under the pressure, whether it's self-imposed or from the dealers, to do another show. So it's a 43 show, a 44 show, a 43. I mean, and so everything fits in a chronological way that is absent in the biographies of many artists.
Yeah.
It's an evolution. And that whole style of sort of Greenbergian writing, that we talk about things, you know, evolving so that in your 1944 show, you were addressing questions that you raised in the 43 show, and so on and so forth. I mean, that Darwinian idea of being an artist is something he was well suited for because of his commercial career, that he had such a regular series of exhibitions. I'm sure a lot of people have to organize all of that. So in these, which can't be dated, I mean, I think that's one of the reasons they're marginalized, is that you don't know where they fit into the story. If you did, then you could suddenly say, oh, these are, you know, afterthoughts to the paintings, or these are, you know, the very first intimations of the paintings. But being unable to say which is which, I think it's kept them out of the story.
And then it's kept it even out of the story of American printmaking in a way. Very few abstract expressionists made prints. The medium was antithetical to them. It was fragmented, it was small scale, it was it required collaboration from other people. And Pollock's one of the few who does make abstract prints. Barnett Newman makes some of Tanya Grossman's, but they're, de Kooning makes some later in his career when he's established. So they're left out of the, they're left out of the canon of American, they, until recently they've been left out of the canon of American printmaking. We thought, the story keeps being rewritten, but you know, there's this break, and the abstract expressionist, de Kooning makes a tiny little print that's published by the Laurel Gallery that's about this big, and it looks like it's just trying to get out of the space. Klein makes one that's even smaller and more constricted. So these, given that, are quite an achievement of, up against his colleagues.
Was that satisfied with all the chronological issues? Good.
One interesting thing to note, I don't purport to know like a ton about Jackson Pollock's life, but I have done a lot of work on Atelier 17. It was at the New School until fall of 1945. So if the story is right that Pollock is there, like in that the fall, the winter of 1944-45, he's there at the New School.
Yes, and it's on 8th Street.
No,
it's on 8th Street, and he lives on...
No, it's on 10th or 12th.
No, it's on 8th.
Where's that
hospital? It was on 8th Street.
It's on 8th Street. And then he's right across the street.
No, the studio, Atelier 17 ends up on 8th Street.
Right.
But the New School, the Joseph Urban building,
right,
is on 12th Street.
Right,
yeah.
Exactly.
So,
it moves from... It's a part of the New School, but doesn't the studio, I don't know this, I'm asking you, doesn't the studio move from?
It does. So in like November 1945, it's established, it's part of the New School. It's like hosting classes down on 8th Street, come in, you know, work, you can still enroll in the New School. And then sometime that year, that academic year, they say, that's it, like we're not going to be affiliated with one another anymore. But it is at the Joseph Urban building until at least the spring of 1945. So,
well, that is funny because he's supposedly across the street on 8th Street.
Exactly. I'm just saying, it's like
a
funny thing that isn't quite right, you know, in what you read about.
Uh-huh.
He's going with Reuben Kadish at night, they've got a key, they're coming in, and it's not. Like, there's something funny about the chronology there that doesn't quite.
So maybe it's 1945 he's doing all.
Maybe
I thought
he moved out to Long Island.
No. That's another. When does he move to Long Island?
Doesn't he get married in 45?
I think
that could be at the end of the year. Yeah,
45.
At the end of 45. Yeah.
Again, who knows?
Yeah.
But it's interesting.
Right.
Exactly, and it doesn't.
And I could always sneak into the New School.
I think it's more interesting that he's working at night and he's working on weekends and he's working alone,
right,
wherever he's working, whether it's on 12th Street or on 8th Street, than across the street.
Peter
made
that student.
Hmm?
Peter made that
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I thought Pollock would have been at home drawing.
That's
the
interesting. You would have thought Pollock would have been at home with a brush and doing the sugarloaf aqua tint, as opposed to a engraving.
Yeah.
That's really, yeah. But he wouldn't have had, the thing about the engraved line is it has this force and it raises up from the surface and this thrust to it. But he wouldn't have gotten it the same way with an etch line. That's just, that, the more you look at that, you know, it's quite amazing.
It is. It has wall, actually has wall power.
Yeah.
I mean, you wouldn't think. Could it?
It would be interesting to sit down with the catalog resident and see what painting that's closest to.
It's not as if my mind hasn't wandered over that question. I don't know that. It's. I mean, I think you could just lose your.
Yes.
Raison if you are spend too much time with a catalog.
Yeah.
And you know, they've really, until so there've been so few times that they've been given their due the way they are now, to be just looked at singularly as works of art.
Yeah.
I think Joan Blackburn deserves a lot of credit.
Yes, she does.
We were certainly apprehensive before we got it up. No, you know, because to have this be absorbed so much, as people are when they come in and really look.
But why would you have been apprehensive?
Because I never saw them up. You know, I mean. All in one group like this. I mean, it was in the Museum Modern Art Show was very interesting, but there was the small greeting cards in color,
and
there were a lot of things going on. This is you can absorb the work in a way. I mean, I think in galleries that you can't any other way. I was having this discussion about the idea now that museums are going to have paintings and prints and photographs and everything all in one room.
That's right.
And I think that's not a good idea. The experience, this kind of experience isn't possible if you're going to the big painting and then photograph of the period and then what this is able to do is lost under those circumstances. I can't go from a big painting to something that's another medium that easily. Maybe you can, I find, and this was a curator who said, and I asked this, said, what do you think about this? And she said, I'm beginning to wonder. Is the modern's doing it, the Whitney's doing it, you know, it's the thing. It robs the essence of the medium, which this room enables.
But the painting feels...
Well, the painting is a drawing.
Well, okay.
And,
but I mean, it fits in perfectly here.
Yes, oh, it does.
Yeah, because it's about life.
Okay.
Well, then I guess it depends.
But I would bet you could, if you had them available to you, you could have chosen, another three or four paintings that would have worked perfectly.
Well, I don't know whether to go from number one to this to that.
Oh, in terms of scale.
Yeah, and the experience.
Right.
This is so close to. It really is. Shows how his facility with the end of the wooden end of a brush, it's extraordinary to go from fifth to thin.
Right.
And it's in a way relates to what you were talking about is the burr, the different kind of line in an engraving.
Yeah, but if you had drawings up, it would be okay. It's about scale, isn't it? I mean, if this were mixed with the psychoanalytic drawings.
Psychoanalytic drawings are very different from these.
No, but I'm saying it wouldn't be the same kind of interruption.
Perhaps not.
Perhaps
although
not.
We could pull out a drawing. And
I have a question for the lady who's the expert on Atelier 17, which is because we sort of said that maybe Hayter didn't have the kind of influence that when you read about it, it says that Hayter had on Pollock and Pollock's line. So what's your opinion
what's
on
my
that?
Opinion?
Yeah.
There's the oft-repeated phrase that Hayter said, or that Pollock said, that he had two masters, Benton and Pollock, and Hayter.
Right.
You know, I don't know. I think there's a lot of prognostication when you're an artist.
So can you stop right there?
Yeah.
Where does that come from?
Yeah, where does that come from?
I think that comes from an interview with Hayter.
It comes from an interview with
Hayter. this is, and then it gets repeated over and over again.
Yeah.
Well,
right?
This is true.
I do think that Hayter was very in it, very with it. And, you know, even though we say that, you know, that the abstract expressions didn't make prints, that there were so many other artists who were around, who were making prints, who were don't know all of them. I mean, we just don't. Some of them came, they were interested in trying it out briefly, and then they left and made like two or three plates. So I just think that Hayter had a lot of, he just had this electric personality, just this dynamism that everyone was drawn to. So as a teacher, I think he had a lot of influence.
But do you think, my original question is, yes. And he changed printmaking because they all, the people who studied there went and then taught at the University of Iowa, Lozansky, and taught all over the country and taught Hayter all over the country. But what was his influence, do you think he had an influence on Pollock?
I mean, I think you look at Pollock's prints, and I think that they have a lot of Hayter's influence, and just a lot of influence of what was going on at that studio. Just his influence on the line. The line is so important to all of them, you know, about how do you use that mirroring to make this type of line, which is so difficult. I mean, if you've ever made a printmaking, it is so difficult to do this. So, it's truly, it's extraordinary. You can say, oh, I wasn't interested in it, or it didn't really influence him, but that is really hard.
Yeah, no.
Okay. Really hard to do. So, it's the same enough interest in him to do it for hours. I mean,
well, you know what, there's nothing explaining how he learns to do it. Everything I see, he just sort of goes and he makes these. You don't just pick up a burin and know how to do that. You could pick up an etching needle and know how to do that, but that's something to do.
Yeah.
So do we think Hayter actually...
I mean, Hayter seems to have taught people, there was kind of by the time you got to New York, you codified a way of teaching people where you get a very small plate and you work on a small plate and you would try all the different techniques. You would do an engraving and then you would do aquatint over it and then you would just see how the plate developed. I don't know if they worked specifically one-on-one together, but there should have been someone there who did teach it. Maybe it was Kadish did print.
Yeah,
maybe
Kadish
taught him at night.
Yeah, exactly.
Somebody taught him.
Somebody taught him.
He didn't just do it.
Right.
You might be interested to know that our next exhibition is Alice Trumbull Mason's prints done at Atelier 17.
Yes, yeah. I wrote about that. I'm in the catalog. I'm Christina Wilde.
Our little cat. I'll give you our little brochure.
Oh, the one that Emily's doing.
Our little brochures that we do.
Yeah.
I mentioned the quote as
he really learns how to do it.
We have the brochure if you'd
okay.
like one.
That suggests some intent.
I can't imagine Pollock in a crowded room working. Really. I mean, with 10 or 12 people working around.
Must have happened.
I can't imagine.
High school.
In high school?
I mean, he must have been in rooms with lots of people.
Yeah, but no, but I mean, doing these. Yeah. It was a very busy
it's
place.
Funny that there are no little scraps of his learning. There are no little, we only have the finished,
right.
We only have the finished
right.
images. There are no scratches, there are no, and he knew Hayter socially, I think. I think he knew Hayter from being around.
Yeah.
Maybe not from the studio.
And Hayter was in Hampton at some point as well, right?
Yeah.
Yeah,
they
were.
Yeah. It's nice when you can't know everything. You know, I feel sorry for the historians of the future where everything will be, you know, documented with cell phone photographs and there won't be anything we can't.
And the same mistakes will be repeated over and over and over
again. Yeah. So I think it's nice.
questions? Don't be shy.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for coming.